Namaskar, good morning. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with Breakfast News. Let's begin the bulletin with the headlines. Hearing concludes in Ayodhya land dispute case. Supreme Court reserves a verdict. Grants 3 days to parties to file written notes on moulding of relief. Three days to go before campaigning concludes in Maharashtra and Haryana. Prime Minister Narendra Modi to address rallies in Maharashtra. Sharad Pawar leads NCP charge. In Haryana, Rajnath Singh to campaign for the BJP. Congress intensifies campaigning. Indian delegation blunts Pakistan's attempt to raise Kashmir issue at IPU in Serbia. Holds it responsible for countless terror attacks. Shashi Tharoor says Pakistan home to 130 terrorists, 25 terror entities. President Ramnath Kovind leaves on a week-long visit to Philippines and Japan. A visit marks 70 years of diplomatic relations with Philippines. President to attend enthronement ceremony of Emperor Naruhito in Japan on 22nd of October. International Day for Eradication of Poverty today. World Bank report says India halved poverty rate since 1990s. Showed strong improvements in most human development outcomes. Our top focus this morning, the Supreme Court has reserved its judgment in the Ram Janmabhoomi Babri Masjid land dispute case. This after the arguments from both the sides concluded after a 40-day hearing, the second longest in the Supreme Court's history. The court has directed both the disputing parties to submit all the written submissions and moulding of reliefs within 3 days. The judgment is expected to be delivered before Chief Justice Ranjan Gogoi retires on 17th of November.
The Supreme Court has reserved its order on Ayodhya land dispute case after concluding the daily hearings held over 40 days. The Apex Court has now directed the concerned parties to submit written submissions in 3 days.
हम लोगों ने जो अपना दलील दिया है उस दलील में बहुत अस्पष्ट है और सारे हिंदू पक्ष के दलील का केंद्र है कि जो एक तिहाई संपत्ति दिया गया था माननीय उच्च न्यायालय के द्वारा मुस्लिम पक्ष को वह गलत निर्णय था वह किस तरह से गलत था कानूनी तौर पर उस निर्णय को सही नहीं ठहराया जा सकता है इन सारे मुद्दों पर हिंदू पक्ष ने अपना पक्ष रखा है और हमें इंतजार करना होगा कि उस पक्ष को माननीय सर्वोच्च न्यायालय किस तरह से लेती है
The five-judge constitution bench, headed by Chief Justice Ranjan Gogoi, is expected to deliver the judgment before the CJI's retirement on November 17.
फैसला रिजर्व किया है जजमेंट रिजर्व किया है कोर्ट ने ये कहा है जो भी पार्टीज को अपने रिटन सबमिशंस देने हैं वो 3 दिन के अंदर अपने रिटन सबमिशंस दे सकते हैं मोल्डिंग ऑफ द रिलीफ पे और कोर्ट ने सारी पार्टीज को हेयर करने के बाद आज इस मामले में अपना फैसला सुरक्षित रखा है
14 appeals have been filed in the top court against the 2010 Allahabad High Court judgment that the 2.77 acre land be partitioned equally among the three parties, the Sunni Waqf Board, the Nirmohi Akhada and Ram Lala. The five-judge constitution bench began day-to-day hearings on August 6th after mediation proceedings by a court-appointed three-member team failed to find an amicable solution to the dispute. The five-judge constitutional bench will conduct in-chamber proceedings on Thursday on the mediation panel's report and will take a call on the way forward. Vipin Chauhan's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And let's now get you all the news and updates from the election battleground in Maharashtra and Haryana. First, let's get you all the developments from Maharashtra. Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lead BJP's election campaign in Maharashtra today. He is scheduled to address rallies in Bid, Satara districts and Pune city. BJP State Unit President Chandrakant Patil is in the fray from Kothrud constituency in Pune city. BJP Working President J.P. Nadda will hold two public meetings in Hingloi district and Ulhasnagar city of Thane district. NCP Chief Sharad Pawar is also slated to campaign in Nasik. On Wednesday, Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed several public rallies in Maharashtra. Addressing the gathering at Akola district, Prime Minister Modi listed Maharashtra government's achievements in the last 5 years. The Prime Minister said, Devendra Fadnavis-led government has worked for the empowerment of poor. He said schemes like Prime Minister Awas Yojana, Ujjwala Yojana and Swachh Bharat have helped people in every village and community.
बीते 5 वर्ष में गरीबों के सशक्तिकरण से सशक्त परिवार, सशक्त समाज और सशक्त राज के निर्माण में हम जुटे हुए हैं। प्रधानमंत्री आवास योजना से लेकर उज्ज्वला योजना तक, स्वच्छ भारत अभियान से लेकर मिशन इंद्रधनुष तक, आयुष्मान भारत योजना से लेकर मुद्रा योजना तक केंद्र सरकार की तमाम योजनाओं का लाभ हर क्षेत्र, हर गांव, हर शहर, हर वर्ग, हर संप्रदाय के लोगों को बिना कोई झिझक मिल रहा है।
Addressing a rally in Parthur in Maharashtra's Jalna, Prime Minister cornered NCP and Congress on the issue of nationalism.
परिवारवाद के बोझ के नीचे कांग्रेस का राष्ट्रवाद दब चुका है। परिवार भक्ति में ही कांग्रेस को राष्ट्रभक्ति नजर आती है और यही वजह है कि कांग्रेस आज लड़खड़ा रही है, अंतिम सांस ले रही है। इसी तरह राष्ट्रवादी कांग्रेस पार्टी में सिर्फ दुनिया भर में जितने करप्शन के प्रकार हैं, सारे करप्शन के ही संस्कार आज वहां बचे हैं।
While in Panvel, Prime Minister Narendra Modi said that formula of Narendra and Devendra will help Maharashtra scale new heights of development if the party is voted back to power.
दिल्ली में नरेंद्र और मुंबई में देवेंद्र, ये नरेंद्र देवेंद्र का ये फॉर्मूला बीते 5 वर्षों में सुपरहिट रहा है, सुपरहिट। और आने वाले वर्षों में ये महाराष्ट्र को विकास के नए आयाम पर पहुंचाने वाला है। और आप ये भी मान लीजिए, देवेंद्र और नरेंद्र जब साथ खड़े होते हैं तो 1+1 2 नहीं होता है। नरेंद्र और देवेंद्र जब साथ खड़े होते हैं तो 11 हो जाता है, 11 हो जाता है।
Meanwhile, NCP Chief Sharad Pawar on Wednesday addressed a public meeting in Bid district of Maharashtra. Addressing the rally, Pawar targeted the BJP and Shiv Sena government in the state. The NCP chief accused the BJP Shiv Sena government of failing on all fronts and said that in the last 5 years, unemployment is on rise. Maharashtra's capital, Mumbai, is also known as the city of dreams. While Maharashtra tops the list with the most startups in the country, the agriculture sector in the state is facing a major crisis. Let's take a look at the economic climate in the state.
Mumbai resident Nirmal Rivaria was a chartered accountant till 4 years ago. But a desire to do something for the society made him quit his job and launch his own startup.
इस सर्विस में हम लोग जो कमाने वाला चला जाता है तो उसके पीछे जो परिवार वाले हैं उनकी हेल्प करते हैं जो भी इन्वेस्टमेंट से उनका क्लेम दिलवाने में तो जो भी लेडी है वो दर दर की ठोकरें नहीं खाए जो भी इन्वेस्टमेंट जो करके गया उसका हस्बैंड उसको हस्बैंड का इन्वेस्टमेंट को उसको दिलाने में सहायता करते हैं.
Like Rewardia, many people have taken advantage of the government's startup drive. Till a few years ago, finding a job was the top priority for youngsters after they finished their education. But this trend has changed over the years, with nearly 23,000 youth launching their own companies since 2015.
जब से हमें पैसा मिला, उस तो ये हमने कम से कम 10 लोगों और बताया. और 10 लोगों को और फायदा हुआ मतलब 10 स्टार्टअप्स और गए वहां पे और 10 स्टार्टअप्स को और फायदा हुआ.
The agriculture sector accounts for a major part of Maharashtra's economy, but the economic survey states that no major changes have taken place in the sector. Moreover, drought has severely affected the economy of the state. Agricultural growth is estimated to be just 0.4%. The government has launched the Jal Yukt Shivar scheme to solve the water problem in the state. The scheme aims to alleviate the water problem in 5,000 villages of the state every year.
Jal Shivar Yojana, aisi ek yojana hai taiyar ki, aur wo us yojana ke andar kafi kam paise mein pure jal saathe ki unhone jo koshish ki hai, to ye sarkar ne kitna acha kaam kiya, ye samajhne ke liye agle saal ko humko dekhna padega.
However, Maharashtra's economic survey shows the state's growth potential, with Maharashtra's economy estimated to grow at 7.5%. This is Nav Vikram Singh's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And now all the election news from Haryana. Political parties intensify efforts to woo voters in Haryana with only 3 days left for campaigning. Defence Minister and BJP leader Rajnath Singh will address public meetings in Haryana today. Singh will hold 3 rallies in Bhavani Khera, Tosham and Mahindragarh Assembly constituencies. Union Home Minister Amit Shah on Wednesday addressed 4 election rallies in Faridabad, Samalkha, Bahadurgarh and Gurugram in poll-bound Haryana. In his address, Shah underscored that in the last 5 years, a new story of development has been written in Haryana under the leadership of Chief Minister Manohar Lal Khattar. He said that during the Congress government in Haryana, corruption, hooliganism and casteism was promoted, while the focus of the BJP government is only development and corruption has been eradicated from the state.
हरियाणा के किसानों की भूमि दिल्ली के दरबार के दामाद को देने का पाप हरियाणा के मुख्यमंत्री हुडा जी ने किया था और हमारे मनोहर लाल जी ने विकास को आगे ले जाने का काम किया है. मित्रों, आज हरियाणा कभी चौटाला कभी हुडा कभी हुडा कभी चौटाला उससे मुक्त हो गया है. चौटाला साहब की सरकार आती थी तो गुंडागिरी होती थी, हुड्डा जी की सरकार आती थी तो भ्रष्टाचार होता था. अब मनोहर लाल खट्टर की सरकार आई है, ना गुंडागिरी है ना भ्रष्टाचार है, सबका विकास हो रहा है, सबका साथ मिल रहा है.
And BSP Chief Mayawati also on a Wednesday addressed a public meeting in Yamunanagar in Haryana. At a rally in Radhaur in Yamunanagar, Mayawati alleged that Dalits, workers and weaker sections of the state have been ignored. Targeting the BJP and Congress, Mayawati said that the BSP wants to form a government with the support of the people. She also underscored the work done for public interest during the BSP government in Uttar Pradesh. She appealed to the people to vote in favour of the party candidates. Haryana has 90 assembly seats, out of which 24 are in the western part of the state, a region that has been a stronghold of INLD. However, this time around, The BJP enjoys a strong footing in Western Haryana aimed at a divided Congress and a weakened INLD. Here is a detailed report.
Western Haryana, once believed to be the stronghold of INLD, is now witnessing the emergence of the BJP as the new power center, courtesy the Modi wave. In fact, BJP is leaving no stone unturned to get the majority of seats in this part of the state, with its top leaders including Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressing multiple rallies here. Five districts are part of Western Haryana. They include Bhiwani, Jind, Fatehabad, Sirsa and Hisar. In terms of assembly seats, four seats fall in Bhiwani, five in Jind, three in Fatehabad, five in Sirsa and seven in Hisar. In 2014, BJP won six seats in Western Haryana, a major climb from the one seat it won in the 2009 assembly polls. The Congress, however, was the biggest loser in 2014. The party was reduced to just one seat in comparison to seven seats it had won in 2009. Meanwhile, the INLD managed to increase its base and won 13 seats in 2014. In 2009, it had won 11 seats. Besides this, other parties won 4 seats in 2014. But this time around, BJP seems to be strong on all seats. That's because of the INLD split in 2018 and the Congress now having presence only in a few pockets. Jananayak Janata Party, which came into existence in 2018 after a vertical split in INLD, following a feud within the Chautala clan, is contesting the polls independently. At the same time, Ashok Tavar, who recently left the Congress, has also declared his support for Dushyant Chautala-led JJP. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And with that, we'll slip into a very quick break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back after the break. At the 141st Assembly of Inter-Parliamentary Union currently underway in Serbia, the Indian delegation led by Lok Sabha Speaker Om Birla rebutted the allegations made by Pakistan on Jammu and Kashmir. Hitting out at Pakistan, India said that it is ironic that a state responsible for countless terrorist attacks in Jammu and Kashmir is trying to masquerade as a champion of international law. Lok Sabha MP Shashi Tharoor told the Assembly that developments in Jammu and Kashmir are an internal matter of India and there should be no interference on the issue from across the border. He said that Pakistan is home to 130 UN-designated terrorists and 25 terrorist entities listed by the UN. And it is absurd to hear its concerns regarding human rights. Tharoor said that Indian delegation hoped that Pakistani delegation would refrain from misusing the forum again.
Pakistan has raised an issue that is internal to India and extraneous to our discussions for narrow political gains. The Indian delegation rejects outright and strongly condemns such references. Madam Chairperson, I am a Member of Parliament from the leading opposition party in India. We will continue to use our parliament to discuss and debate with our own government on Kashmir and other issues. We will, however, fight our own battles democratically and do not need or welcome interference from across the border.
President Ramnath Kovind has embarked on a week-long two-nation visit to the Philippines and Japan from October 17th to 23rd. President Kovind will visit Philippines from October 17th to 21st and Japan from October 21st to 23rd. He will hold restricted and delegation-level talks with his Filipino counterpart in Manila. The visit is taking place on the occasion of 70 years of establishment of diplomatic relations between the two countries. And the Ministry of External Affairs said that the President will attend the enthronement ceremony of the Emperor of Japan, Naruhito.
Rashtrapati ji and First Lady will be paying a state visit to the Philippines. The Philippines visit will be from the 17th to 21st of October, and this visit is at the invitation of the President of the Republic of Philippines, His Excellency Mr. Rodrigo Duterte. Thereafter, Rashtrapati ji will visit Japan from 21st to 23rd, and that would be to attend ceremonies related to the accession to the Chrysanthemum throne by His Majesty the Emperor Norihito, who had ascended on the throne on 1st of May 2019. Purposes is of Rashtrapati ji's visit to see and flag the importance of economic engagement between our two countries. And not only on trade, but also we would be looking at, and we already do have ongoing cooperations with Philippines in various fields. We have it in health, we have in agriculture, we have in renewable energy and counterterrorism.
And as the world observes International Day of Eradication of Poverty, the World Bank has said that India has halved its poverty rate since 1990s. The World Bank said that in the last 15 years, India has achieved a 7+ growth rate. Ahead of the annual meeting with the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank said that India has enjoyed strong improvements in most human development outcomes. The World Bank noted that India's growth is expected to continue and elimination of extreme poverty in the decades is within reach. It also said that India is critical to the success of global development efforts, including eliminating extreme poverty and climate change. According to the latest census, India's livestock population has increased to 535.78 million, with the number of cows rising 18% to 145.12 million as compared to 2012. The Livestock Census 2019, released on Wednesday, showed that the population of sheep, goat and mithun grew in double digits, while the count of horses and ponies, pigs, camels, donkeys, mules and yaks declined. The total livestock population is 535.78 million in the country, showing an increase of 4.6% over Livestock Census 2012. Among the states, West Bengal reported the highest increase of 23.32% in livestock population, followed by Telangana with 22.21%, Andhra Pradesh 15.79%, Bihar 10.67% and Madhya Pradesh 11.81%. However, the livestock population witnessed a decline of 1.35% in Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan and Gujarat. The Chenani-Nashri Tunnel, the longest tunnel in Jammu and Kashmir, will be renamed after Bharatiya Janasangh founder Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. The announcement was made by Union Road Transport Minister Nitin Gadkari on Wednesday. Gadkari said that Mukherjee's battle for Kashmir, one nation, one flag, has immensely contributed to the national integration. The 9.2-kilometer-long tunnel was inaugurated by Prime Minister Narendra Modi in 2017. The bi-directional tunnel reduces the distance between Jammu and Srinagar by 30 kilometers. Government of Jammu and Kashmir has ordered for shifting of headquarters of Administrative Secretary, Ladakh Affairs Department to Leh, Ladakh with immediate effect. As per an order by its General Administrative Department, the decision has been taken to oversee the transition of Ladakh to Union Territory in terms of Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act 2019. On August 5th, Centre had abrogated Article 370 and also bifurcated the former state into Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. The new Union Territories will come into being on October 31st. In a major bus accident in Saudi Arabia, 35 foreigners were killed and 4 others injured. The accident took place near the Muslim holy city on Wednesday. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has expressed anguish at the death of in the mishap. He has offered condolences to the bereaved families. The US House of Representatives have voted overwhelmingly to condemn the President Trump's withdrawal of US forces from Syria, with both Democrats and Republicans approving the measure. Meanwhile, Donald Trump has said that Turkey's incursion into Syria is not our border and called the former US allies, the Kurds, no angels. The US is facing intense criticism for withdrawing its forces from Syria, which some say gave Turkey the green light to launch a cross-border offensive against Kurdish-led forces. On Wednesday, Turkey ruled out any negotiation with Kurdish militants in Syria. It also dismissed calls from foreign powers, including US, for an immediate ceasefire in northeast Syria. Meanwhile, senior US leaders Mike Pence and Mike Pompeo have headed to Turkey for emergency talks to try to persuade Ankara to halt an assault on northern Syria. And sports news now, Saina Nehwal and Kidambi Srikanth suffered first round losses in the Denmark Open women's and men's singles competition on Wednesday. Kidambi Srikanth was knocked out of Denmark Open after losing 14-21, 18-21 to his Danish opponent Anders Antonsen in the first round. Earlier in the day, Saina Nehwal had also crashed out of the competition after going down in straight games to Japan's Sayaka Takahashi. Saina lost 15-21, 21-23 in the women's singles match that lasted 37 minutes. Pranav Chopra and N. Sikki Reddy defeated their German opponents to advance to the next rounds in the tournaments. On Tuesday, world champion P.V. Sindhu and B. Sai Praneeth made impressive starts to their campaign, while Parupalli Kashyap and Saurabh Verma crashed out early after losing their first round matches. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. Thank you for watching. Namaskar.